The Open Systems Intercommunication Model, or also known as the OSI Model, is a conceptual framework used to understand and describe the functions and interactions of networking protocols. It provides a systematic approach to break down complex networking processes into manageable layers. In essence, it consists of 7 distinct layers, each responsible for specific tasks and communication functions. In this video, we will understand what is OSI model in networking, explore each layer in detail, understand their functionalities, and provide relevant examples to each OSI layer to grasp the concept effectively. So, let's get started. Number 1, the physical layer, or layer 1. This layer is the first and lowest layer in the OSI model. It deals with the physical transmission of data over the network medium, whether it can be copper cables, fiber optics, or wireless signals. This layer's primary focus is to establish and maintain a reliable communication link between devices. It encodes binary data into electrical, optical, or radio signals suitable for transmission over the chosen medium. The key functions of this layer are physical topology, in which the physical layer defines how devices are physically connected, such as point-to-point, bus, star, or mesh topologies. Transmission mode, which defines the direction of data flow, either simplex, which is one-way communication, half-duplex, which is bidirectional but not simultaneous, or full-duplex, which is bidirectional and simultaneous communication. Physical signaling. This involves the modulation and encoding of data bits into signals suitable for transmission. For instance, the physical layer converts digital data into analog signals for transmissions over analog media. Bitrate and bandwidth. In this, the physical layer determines the data rate or bit rate at which data is transmitted and the bandwidth, which refers to the range of frequencies available for data transmission. For example, imagine sending a text message from your smartphone to a friend's device using a cellular network. The physical layer would be responsible for converting your text message into electrical signals and transmitting them through the cellular towers to reach your friend's device. Next, number 2, the data link layer, or layer 2. This layer provides a reliable point-to-point or point-to-multipoint data link between two directly connected nodes in a network. It is responsible for error detection, flow control, and managing access to the physical transmission medium to avoid data collisions. The key functions of this layer are frame encapsulation, wherein the data link layer breaks down the data received from the network layer into smaller frames, adding headers and traders for identification and error checking. Media access control, or MAC. Now, MAC sublayer is responsible for managing access to the physical medium, especially in shared networks. Popular MAC protocols include CSMA/CD, used in Ethernet, and CSMA/CA, used in Wi-Fi. Next, error detection and correction. This layer is responsible to detect and, if possible, correct errors that may occur during data transmission. For example, the cyclic redundancy check, or CRC, is used for error detection in Ethernet frames. Flow control. Now, the data link layer also ensures that data flow between devices is regulated to prevent data loss or to prevent overwhelming the receiving device. For example, consider a scenario where multiple computers are connected in a local area network, or LAN, using Ethernet switches. When one computer wants to send data to another computer on the same LAN, the data link layer will encapsulate the data into frames, add source and destination MAC addresses, and use the MAC protocols to manage access to the Ethernet medium. Now, if errors are detected in the received frames, the data link layer may request retransmission of those frames. Next, number 3, the network layer, or layer 3. This layer deals with routing data packets from the source to the destination across multiple networks, regardless of whether they are directly connected or not. It enables inter-network communication and makes forwarding decisions based on logical addressing, such as IP addresses. The key functions of this layer are routing, wherein the network layer determines the best path for data to reach its destination, considering factors like hop count, network congestion, and link reliability. Next, logical addressing. Now, IP addresses as we know them are used at the network layer to uniquely identify devices within a network and across different networks. IPv4 and IPv6 are the most commonly used IP versions. Next, packet forwarding, in which network layer is responsible to take data from the transport layer, breaks it into packets and adds the necessary routing information to each packet. Fragmentation and reassembly. Now, if the data is too large to fit into a single packet, the network layer may fragment it into smaller packets for transmission and reassemble them at the destination. For example, imagine you are browsing a website hosted on a server located in a different country. Here, when you send a request to access the website, the network layer in your router determines the best path for the data packets to traverse across various networks, like your local ISP network, international backbones, and the server's network. It uses IP addresses to route the packets to the correct destination, ensuring your request reaches the server and the server's response finds its way back to your device. Next, number 4, the transport layer or layer 4. This layer is responsible for end-to-end communication between two devices on the network and ensures reliability and orderly delivery of data by establishing, maintaining, and terminating logical connections if necessary. The difference between network layer and transport layer is that network layer handles routing and forwarding of data packets between different networks, while the transport layer ensures reliable data delivery and end-to-end communication between applications. The key functions of this layer are segmentation and reassembly, in which transport layer divides the data received from application layer into smaller segments and reassembles them at the destination. Connection establishment and termination. So, in connection-oriented protocols like TCP or transmission control protocol, the transport layer establishes and terminates logical connection to ensure reliable data delivery. Flow control and congestion control, wherein the transport layer manages data flow to prevent overwhelming the receiving device and implements congestion control to regulate data flow within the network. Next, error detection and recovery, as this layer performs error checking using sequence numbers and acknowledgements to detect and recover from lost or corrupted segments. Now, for example, when you download a large file from a remote server, the transport layer will be responsible for breaking the file into smaller segments and ensuring they are reliably delivered to your computer. And also, if any segment is lost or corrupted during the transmission, the transport layer will request a retransmission until all segments successfully are received and reassembled. Next, number 5, the session layer or layer 5. Now, this layer is like a traffic manager that helps application on different devices to establish, maintain, and terminate their communication sessions effectively. It ensures that the data exchange between the application is orderly and reliable. The key functions of this layer are session establishment and termination, wherein the session layer is responsible for establishing and terminating sessions or connections between applications. It also sets up checkpoints for synchronization during data exchange. Session management, as this layer maintains and synchronizes the dialogue between applications, allowing them to resume data exchange after an interruption or failure. Next, token management, as in token-based networks, the session layer manages the token passing, allowing devices to have controlled access to the network. Now, for example, imagine you're using a video conferencing application to communicate with your colleagues. The session layer would handle the setup and maintenance of the video conferencing session, and it would be the one to enable synchronization between video and audio streams, ensuring a seamless and uninterrupted communication experience. Next, number 6, the presentation layer or layer 6. Now, this layer is responsible for data representation, ensuring that data from application layer is converted into a format understandable by the receiving applications. It deals with data compression, encryption, and data syntax conversion. The key functions of this layer are data encryption and decryption, wherein the presentation layer encrypts sensitive data before transmission and decrypts it at the receiving end to ensure secure communication. Data compression, as this layer reduces the size of data to minimize bandwidth usage and improve transmission efficiency. data translation and formatting, in which the presentation layer translates data between different formats, ensuring compatibility between different systems. For example, let's suppose you are sending a PowerPoint presentation to a colleague via email. The presentation layer would compress the presentation to reduce its file size, ensuring faster email transmission. At recipient's end, the presentation layer would decompress the presentation, enabling your colleague to view the original slides without any loss of content. Next, number 7, the application layer or layer 7. Well, this is the topmost layer of the OSI model and is responsible for providing network services directly to end users and applications. Here, it acts as an intermediary between the software applications used by end users and lower layers that handle the actual data transmission and routing across the network. So, we can also say that the application layer simplifies the complexities of network communication by hiding the intricacies of lower-level protocols, thereby enabling applications to easily utilize network services and communicate with each other effortlessly. The key functions of this layer are network service access, wherein the application layer provides an interface for applications to access network services like email, file transfer, remote login, and web browsing. Application protocols, as this layer encompasses various application layer protocols such as HTTP, which stands for Hypertext Transfer Protocol, SMTP, which stands for Simple Mail Transfer Protocol, FTP, which stands for File Transfer Protocol, and DNS, which stands for Domain Name Systems, etc. Next, user interface. So, the application layer can provide a user interface for users to interact with the application and access network services seamlessly. For example, when you use a web browser to access a website, the application layer is responsible for handling the HTTP request and response. It is the one which communicates with the lower layers to ensure that the data is transmitted to and received from the web server correctly. Lastly, in conclusion, I'd like to say that the OSI model is crucial for comprehending network protocols, troubleshooting, and optimizing network performance, thereby providing a layered framework for communication and service delivery in various scenarios. With that, I hope this video was helpful to you and served value. If you like my content, feel free to smash that like button, and if you haven't already subscribed to my channel, please do, as it keeps me motivated and helps me create more content like this for you.